Hi guys, my name is Mirko Schmiedl. I'm the CEO and co-founder of StakingWards, and today we're going to talk about proof of stake, why we need proof of stake, why proof of stake is indispensable for worlds of multiple blockchains, and why the whole proof of stake and proof of work debate is kind of silly. And let's start from the beginning. And so blockchains are valuable because they are trustless, immutable, permissionless, and decentralized. And to achieve those values, the current state of the blockchain is distributed between multiple people around the world. And to protect these values, we need to achieve consensus between all the different people validating the blockchain. So how do we achieve consensus between distributed ledgers? And yeah, basically the optimal thing would be if we could tie these validation rights to real world identities. But since blockchains are entirely digital, we need a digital resource that we can tie these validation rights to. If we would tie it to our identity, these digital rights, then it would be kind of not trustless anymore, but in a way trusted. So we need a public resource that's digital, that's limited and equally accessible to everyone in the world to be truly decentralized. So the first idea is to just tie these real-world identities to internet identities. So we have IP addresses for every computer in the world. That's pretty much fair game and allowing everyone to participate, and it's decentralized all around the world. The problem there is the problem of fake profiles. So anyone can really create multiple IP addresses, and there's no limit to that really. So anyone can fake these. So there's definitely a problem. And then, we have this idea of one CPU, one vote, which was introduced by Satoshi Nakamoto in 2009. And this avoids the fake profiles. It's trustless and it's very secure. And yeah, because it's very secure, because a lot of electricity has to be burned and hardware has to be developed in order to get those blockchain validation rights. So that's very expensive to do so, and not everyone can do it like unlimited, like creating IP addresses, for example. But yeah, then there is a problem with fungibility with proof of work. So if we say one CPU, one vote, CPU is always fungible. And this means that there can always be only one chain in the world, because every other chain that's not the biggest chain can be very easily attacked from the CPU power of the biggest chain. And yeah, there are different cryptographic puzzles and specialized hardware like ASICs and stuff. But as technology advances, this is a very critical and a pressing issue for every other proof of work chain opposed to Bitcoin, really. And yeah, this kind of proves that Bitcoin is designed for maximalism. And yeah, the idea is to have no other chain than Bitcoin, and everything is built on top of Bitcoin. And ironically, this goes totally against like the libertarian core values from a lot of these Bitcoiners, what they are praising. And yeah, like the other idea introduced in 2012 is to have the idea of one coin, one vote, which is basically proof of stake. So the more coins you have, the more votes you have. And since the native currency of the blockchain has value, this value serves as a collateral and has an intrinsic value. And yeah, this basically has very aligned incentives between stakeholders and between blockchain validators, because they are pretty much the same. And yeah, it's very fair competition for the best chain, because there can be like multiple chains and they're always tied to their own native currency, which is not fungible with the other chain. And it's very secure, because you need to purchase at least 51% of the whole network, which is much more expensive than in proof of work. It's trustless and it's very decentralized. And yeah, so to go back like to the slide like with the public resource, so we have the coin, which is 100% digital, opposed to CPU, which is not entirely digital because it it's just digitally produced by non-digitally electricity, actually. So it's 100% digital. And it's also 100% limited. I mean, it depends on the economic design of the chain, but it's much more limited than, for example, electricity or CPU or something. And it's also 100% equally accessible as long as there's liquidity in the market to purchase the coin. So what are the challenges with proof of stake? One of the key challenges we identified is like the initial token distribution. So it's very important to bootstrap a network to have a wide token distribution and to have the token distributed to those people who really care about the network. So that's a key challenge for every network, to have a right token distribution. Another challenge is the economic design decisions which are made, and they need to be upgradable as well. In proof of stake, there's a lot more design space, but there's also like this design space needs to be utilized really. Because it's very important like how these economics are, who has voting rights and who can accumulate how much voting power and so on. That's very important, but there is a lot of design space to address all of these issues really. And another factor is like the unpredictable user behavior. So all of these economic designs, they are based on game theory written out in white papers, but they don't really account for unpredictable user behavior, and they always assume users acting in their own best interest, and they're acting according to the game theoretic principles. We might have to take into account that users can be lazy and can be dumb, and there's not always, not everyone acts in its own best interest, really. So that's definitely a challenge as well. But luckily, proof of stake blockchains are very easy to govern because stakeholders own the votes directly. And yeah, that's opposed to proof of work, where there's a lot of distributed governance and that leads to inefficiency. Like we've seen that with the large brokers and small brokers and stuff. I mean, it's been very difficult to achieve consensus and upgrade the chain. So that's much easier because the incentives are aligned, and it's very clear. It's very like easy to introduce like a formal process for governance that everyone can agree on. On the other side, it's also much more decentralized. When we look at the economies of scale in proof of work and in proof of stake, it's very clear that in proof of stake you have a linear economy of scale, and in proof of work you have an exponential economy of scale. That's because as companies develop mining technology and they develop ASICs, they get a much better advantage compared to others. And also, like if you accumulate energy and electricity and stuff, like the more electricity you produce, the cheaper you get the electricity. So there's a very clear economy of scale that leads to centralization, and this is really an issue that's been addressed with proof of stake. And also we can talk about environmental sustainability. Definitely it's very clear proof of stake uses a lot of proof of stake is way more efficient than proof of work. Proof of work uses like the energy of like same as big nation states, and like the mining hardware is just dumped after 1.5 to 3 years or something because they are outdated. And proof of stake is just like way, way more energy efficient. And in general, proof of stake is more efficient also in terms of like what's the cost of securing the blockchain. So in proof of work, you need around 6.5% of the whole network value to secure the blockchain. That's like the cost that goes into electricity and mining hardware. And on the other side, you have proof of stake, which is way more efficient, and it doesn't require a lot of capital to secure the chain, really. Also, proof of stake is way more scalable, and we've seen that with a lot of blockchains that are already way more scalable right now than Bitcoin, like for example Solana and other charting chains, and Ethereum 2.0 is going to be way, way more scalable. And yeah, that's mainly because no work has to be done, and all these checks to distribute those checks of the work, they have no latency, and validation rights can be defined before any validation is done, because these coins are owned and are always in the wallets of the people. And yeah, there are other mechanisms in proof of stake, like in Tendermint, for example, you have instant finality as well, where like 66% of the network agree on that this block is final. Whereas in Bitcoin, you have like sometimes, you could take like up to 6 blocks, or like an hour or 2 hours, 3 hours to consider a block final. Some people are like waiting for 1 or 2 days to consider a block final. So that's really an issue, and it's been addressed by proof of stake. And also we have much higher transaction throughput. And yeah, we have a much larger design space as well, which allows for technologies like sharding and so on, really. It's really endless what you can do on proof of stake chains with the transaction throughput, which can achieve levels, I'm very sure, much bigger and much more powerful than any Visa network or whatever. And this can really account for big computations as well. So this is definitely the technology you want for blockchains that provide real utility to the world by applying applications, smart contracts, and all of this, really. And another point is the cool thing in proof of stake is that stakeholders can hedge the inflation of the network by participating. So pretty much in proof of stake, like all the value accumulates inside the system. And the beautiful thing is users are incentivized to secure the system, and they are incentivized to govern the system. So like it's very aligned incentives, which makes the users also the owners, and that's just beautiful. And that's what we have been doing at Staking Rewards. I've been researching these topics since 2013 because I've been fascinated by it. We are aggregating the data since 2017 when I started the website together with my brother Yannick. We are helping users to navigate the space. We are identifying staking opportunities from over 200 assets. We are vetting these risks and educating users and educating protocols, educating any stakeholder in the ecosystem, accumulating data, standardizing data, to provide data and education for an overall healthy staking ecosystem that makes proof of stake safe and secure. And yeah, that was my presentation. Thanks a lot for listening. My name is Mirko Schmiedl. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Staking Rewards. You can follow me on Twitter at Berlin Crypto. And yeah, thanks a lot for listening.